Nice. Let's get started. So, now we know we have a spherically symmetric system, a spherically symmetric object, which is not rotating. It can only expand and contract. This we know because of the Birkhoff theorem. And we know how gravity is behaving inside the object. Okay? That's the expression that I gave you before. Where the energy momentum tensor is different than zero. So we are not in vacuum, we are in matter. Then, you know, you can extend yourself your radius of interest, and you end up where there is not any more the material, and you are then considering vacuum, the vacuum solution. So we can use as well this expression to investigate the properties of gravity outside the object. And in this case, we talk about the Schwarzschild metric. Or space-time. Which is characterized by a metric. You can also, sometimes you also refer to it as the exterior solution. Because what is happening now is that we have our spherically symmetric object sitting at the origin of our system. This is the size of the object. We consider T mu nu that is valid for every r. Okay, so we can define our function T mu nu, which depends on the position. And for r larger than r, then the pressure is going to be zero because there is nothing there. And the density is going to be zero because there is nothing there. We are in vacuum. Okay? Therefore, our energy momentum tensor, all the components, will be some function that looks as it looks, I don't know, up to the point of r, and then goes to zero. So if we take the density component, we start with perhaps a star, which is denser in the core, and then it gets weaker and weaker, the density drops down to a certain point. Tuck, here the star finishes, and then we have zero, if we are thinking about the density, for instance. Okay? And the pressure, again, is going to be some other function that arrives here, and then, I mean, up to a certain point, and then is zero. So we can use the expression that we had before, and everything is characterized by our function m of r. And that's equal to 4 pi, and then we have the integral between 0 and r of rho r prime square dr prime. So we just perform our integral, so we have our m, and we know that for r larger than the size, this is going to be a constant. Because if we are considering now matter, we start from zero, the amount of matter within the radius r is equal to zero. Then it grows up to this point, then there is not anymore, if I perform the integral on this area, I'm integrating over zero, therefore our integral m of r is constant. Okay? So we are in this scenario for r larger than r. Now we can integrate our function dA over the r that we had in our hands before. So that's going to be equal to gm plus 4 pi p r to the power of 3 over r minus 2 gm over c to the power of 2 c to the power of 2. But what is the pressure at this distance? Zero. That's equal to zero. We are left with that. You see? What is the only variable? M is a constant. Who is the radius? You see, A is a function of R. Good, therefore, we just perform our integral and we get gm over c to the power of p, integral between 0 and r of r prime minus 2 gm over c to the power of 2 to the minus 1 integrated over the r prime. Just performing the integral, which is equal to 1 half. Then we have the logarithm of 1 minus 2 gm over r c squared. And this kind of makes sense, because if for r going to infinity, a is actually equal to 0, which makes sense, because our g 0, 0 component of the metric is e to the 2a. If a is equal to 0, this is equal to minus 1. It's Minkowski. Infinitely far away from a source of gravity, your metric is flat, because your source is too far away, is at infinite with respect to you. Having that, we have A, we just have to plug this expression into here, and we have the explicit expression of G00. You see, we have a logarithm, we have an exponential, that give us our G00. G00 is equal to minus e to the 2e of r, and this is equal to minus 1 minus 2 gm over c squared over r. And now I define the Schwarzschild radius, which is a constant given the total matter content of our object. And we are done. We have our full metric in an explicit form, which is only a function of the radius. For the r square is going to be equal to what we just derived, 1 minus rs over r, c square dt square, plus 1 minus rs over r to the minus 1, the r squared, plus r multiplied d squared d theta squared plus sinus of theta d theta squared. And this is the Schwarzschild metric. If you're considering yourself very, very far away from your object, you can approximate this guy as plus 1 plus rs over r. This is for r far away from your source. Yes?
Is it sinus theta?
Sorry, let me correct this. Rs way larger than the Schwarzschild radius. So if your distance is way larger with respect to the Schwarzschild radius. Ah, yes, squared. Thanks. So squared. Okay? All the rest is the same. Good. And you can play the game and see that this guy actually agrees with our weak field limit that we investigated in the previous lectures. Now look at this metric and tell me what's the problem here. Yes? That's correct. So, if we are in this scenario, in which this is our object, which has a size r, and the Schwarzschild radius rs is exposed, so we are in vacuum, and therefore we need to use this metric. If we are in this case, rs is in our spacetime. We see it, is there. But we have two singularities, actually. You see? Rs over R, Rs over R. And the two singularities are R equal to zero, because this guy alone goes to infinity, and then R equal to Rs. Because when R is equal to Rs, we have 1 minus 1 to the power of minus 1, which is 1 over 0, again an infinity. Are we screwed? Not quite. Not really, because here we are considering the metric elements. Okay? And the metric elements are given by the basis set. Remember the G mu nu is equal to G basis mu basis nu. Perhaps we have just chosen the wrong systems. We have just used the wrong coordinates. And this is the case for this singularity. So this singularity is only due by our poor choice of coordinates. So this is only a coordinate singularity. Whereas this guy here is real. We cannot do anything, it's a real singularity, meaning is a bug, if you want to call it so, in the space-time itself. It's a bug, if you want, on the manifold itself. It gives you the boundary of your manifold. Whereas this is only due by our poor choice of coordinate system, and you can verify that by looking at the invariance of the related to the curvature in that location. So you can look at the contractions, for example, the full contraction of the Riemann tensor, and you find out that it is finite. So in that location, the curvature is just a real number. So it's a healthy place of your manifold. Okay? It's a little bit like the polar coordinates when you have chosen the poles. Then there is fully degenerate. Then the meaning of the angles are fully degenerate, and it's a poor choice for that coordinate system, for that location. So what we can do to live a better life, if you wish, and try to deal with that location as well, we are going to change the coordinates, okay? One thing is that when this is the case, then this object is called black hole. The sun, for instance, is not a black hole, because if you look at its matter distribution, and if you imagine to compress all of its matter, if you compress its matter in one point, Rs is well within the Schwarzschild, the size of the sun itself. And this metric is not applicable. Okay? Imagine to compress the sun, the Schwarzschild radius would be inside the real size of the sun itself. And here the Schwarzschild metric is not applicable. That stuff, you forget about it. You need to use the solutions that we did in the previous lecture, on the previous boards. Okay? Yes? Yeah, here, but what I did here is to assume that m is different than zero.
I mean, you say that it has for r equals to zero similarity, right?
Yes.
But for r equals to zero, we may not apply this metric. We should use the inferior
Yes, you know, this is just a mathematical representation in which the size of objects are not identified, okay? So because you can, if you wish, it's not a physical place. Because if you go at R equal to zero, then it means that you should have a metal content within R equal to zero. It means an infinite density, okay? So it's not a real physical place. I believe not, but I think not. But I'm not sure. But I think it doesn't. But I'm not sure. Okay. Then we will see. When dealing with black holes and these sort of objects, I'm going to discuss L0 again once more. Okay. For now, we can just leave it here, and think that we are dealing in the regions in which we are far away from RS. Or if you want. We are dealing with objects in which the Schwarzschild radius is inside the matter, is inside the object, therefore not a black hole. The Earth, for instance. We can use this metric to describe the Earth, the exterior of the Earth, of Jupiter, of the Sun, of whatever, when you are in vacuum away from RS. Or, let's say, 40 sort of objects also on the surface, because this metric is valid. If you are dealing with a black hole, you have to be far away from RS, because when you approach RS, things get a little trickier. Well, this is valid again, sorry, also for all objects, but when we are going to approach RS, we are going to see weirdnesses that are happening with this choice of coordinates. Okay? Good. Now we have the metric, and it's fun to see how things moves around these sort of objects within this metric. If we have an object which is a material, a particle which has a mass, let's see what is the equation of motion. If we have a photon, which is a particle with a mass equal to zero, let's see what is going to be the trajectory, the path of these massless particles. So, I don't need to tell you what to do, because you already know. We are dealing, in this case, with free-falling objects, so there is not an external force applied on the object for free particles. And if we want to look at the trajectory of this sort of particles, we just need to use the geodesic equation. There is one way. The other way that we also followed in the past lecture is to use the least action principle. So, or least action principle, from which we can identify the Lagrangian of our system and then apply it to the Euler Lagrange equations that give us the equation of motion of our particle. Okay? I'm going to use the latter approach because it's a little bit more, it's going to give us more insights on the behaviors of particles and the properties of gravity in the Schwarzschild metric. So let's do that. One. We need to identify our Lagrangian. So we have our metric, so our free particle that we have already seen several times, u, mu, u, nu, and the tau. And you see that what is inside the square root is the scalar product. So I can write it in a symbolic fashion. Square root remains, and then we have the square root of the scalar product of the four velocity with itself. So this is the action action S. Then we apply the least action principle, meaning that, and we just apply to this object. Therefore, we are going to have the least action principle. We need to compute the derivatives to the square root of this object, of the scalar product between u and u in itself. Therefore, we have our constants, mc. Then we have the square root that give us a factor of 1/2. Then we have the variation of u over square root of minus u in the tau. And now look, what is the scalar product of u? Is equal to minus c squared multiplied with a minus is c squared, square root, all of this guy is equal to c. That cancel with that. Okay, nice trick. Because now what we have, we see that, you remember these two are two linear operators, I can do that, so I bring it back outside, and you see that our we identified an effective Lagrangian in which we can just use this the scalar product UU. Okay? So from this Lagrangian here, we end up finding out that is to look at the equation of motion of objects is equivalent of using the Lagrangian of this guy here. Same equation of motion. So let's now find the explicit version of our Lagrangian. So let me copy it here so that you have it nice and clean. So this is the scalar product. Now I rewrite it in an explicit form. So that's g mu, u nu. And we have the metric. We have the Schwarzschild metric. That we plug into there. So that we have minus 1 minus rs over r, c squared dt squared, plus 1 minus, t dot, yes, minus 1 rs over r, and then we have r dot squared, plus r squared, t dot squared, plus sinus of theta, phi dot squared. I remind you that again, when you have u mu, which is equal to dx mu, that's defined as over the tau. And I'm defining this guy as x mu dot. Okay, so you see the four velocity, u mu, is the x, our coordinates, over the tau, and I just identify with the dot. Yes?
Is there a dt on the left side?
Where, sorry?
The left side, is c squared dt squared or c squared
dt dot? Dot, dot. That's a c squared dot. C squared dot. So it's the dot. Oh, you're right. There shouldn't be that t. Yeah. Thanks. No, no, you're right. Okay, good. But then we can notice also something else. This guy, look what the Lagrangian is equal to. It's a constant. L is equal to u, the scalar product. which is equal to what? If we have a massive particle, this is equal to minus c squared. If we are dealing with a massless particle, this is equal to zero. Therefore, what we can do is to say, if this is the case, then I can say that this guy is equal to minus c squared and times epsilon, where I say that epsilon is equal to 1 for massive particles, and epsilon is equal to 0 for massless particles, such that with this single expression, I can deal at the same time with massive and massless particles. Then we can apply this our Lagrangian to the Euler Lagrangian equations. And as a start, I will consider the theta component of the set of Euler Lagrangian equations. So we have d over the tau, the L over the theta dot, minus the L over the tau equal to zero. That's the Euler Lagrangian equation, right? So what we do, we have our Lagrangian, all of that, and we just plug it into here. If we do so, we end up with d over d tau equal to s squared theta dot squared minus r squared cosinus of theta phi dot squared of theta dot equal to zero. Now we can rotate our coordinate system. We look for a time slice, so we are looking for a specific instant. Set theta, and we set the coordinates such that theta is equal to pi half. What does it mean? That this guy is going to disappear. And we get that r squared theta dot squared is equal to a constant. And furthermore, we can set our coordinate system such that phi dot is equal to zero. What does it mean? That this guy is then equal to zero. So all of this, so large fraction of our Lagrangian is actually not needed if we make that. Therefore, we can identify our effective Lagrangian. As L equal to minus 1 minus RS over R, C squared T dot squared, plus 1 minus rs over r to the minus 1 r dot square, and that's it. And yes, that's it. Now that we made our life as simple as humanly possible, we can get immediate results. So out of that, we can identify easily cyclic coordinates. Meaning, we can identify conserved quantities. uh, something that we already did, because there we found something that was conserved. We can identify an effective radial potential. For gravity, we can derive the equation of motion of particles, both massive and massless, once by exploiting this trick. Okay? This is everything coming up, popping up from the Lagrangian. So let's get started. With step one, we can identify the cyclic coordinates. And the result is immediate, because the cyclic coordinates are those that do not appear explicitly in the Lagrangian. Do you see T there? No. You see T dot, but T dot is another variable. T is not there. Do you see theta there? No. Therefore, theta is the other conserved quantities. And then using Euler-Lagrange equation, as we did before, you see, we can identify a conserved quantity, something that is not changing. You see, the tau over the something is equal to a constant. Therefore, the L over the theta dot is equal to R squared, which is the first part, you see, of the Euler-Lagrange equation. So you see, we take the Euler-Lagrange equation. There is not an explicit dependence with respect to theta, for example. This is equal to zero, using that Lagrangian, okay? What we are left is d over the tau of this object, equal to zero. Therefore, we look at this guy and we see that this is conserved. Okay, because its variation with respect to time is equal to zero, meaning it's constant. And we end up with R theta equal to L, and this is the angular momentum. Then we do the same for the time. Do I fit here? Let me write it here. The L over the T dot with the C is equal to minus 1 over C, 1 minus RS over R, C squared, 2 T dot. And we define it as 2 times the energy of the particle. Why the factor of 2? Because I dropped a 1/2 into the Lagrangian, okay? With the 1/2 in the Lagrangian, you would have a kinetic term that looks like 1/2 velocity squared, okay? I didn't put it there, therefore it means that everything is expressed with twice of the energy of our particle. Okay, and then in the notes, I also give you a link to the fact that you can express you can find out these invariants by looking at the Killing vectors, right? In this case, the Killing vector for time is the derivative of time, the t, and for theta is the Killing vector is the derivative of the theta angle. Okay? Good. Step two. We can identify an effective potential which comprehends the contribution of the angular momentum L and of gravity. And we care about the distance with respect to the center, R, right? It's spherically symmetric, so it doesn't matter where we are placing ourselves. The only variable that is relevant is the separation between the center R. So what we do, we use the conserved quantities that we have from there, that we have here, the angular momentum and the energy, to get rid of the variable theta dot and t dot. Because you see now we have expressions in which we can write theta dot is equal to L over R square. Okay? Therefore, in our Lagrangian, the theta dot and the t dot can be get rid of. Okay? They can go away from there. So let's continue. L is equal to minus c squared epsilon, remember from before, minus 1 minus rs over r c squared t dot square. Then we can substitute plus 1 minus rs over r to the minus 1 r dot square plus r squared theta dot square. See, I am restoring, I'm now letting my system free such that we can have also a velocity with respect to the coordinate theta, okay? So the trick before was just to identify the conserved quantity there. Then what we do, we can get rid of theta prime and t prime by using our definition of the conserved, by using the conserved quantities. And therefore we get minus 1 minus rs over r of e squared 1 minus rs over r to the minus 2 plus 1 minus rs over r to the minus 2. It should be minus 1. Minus 1. R dot square plus R square over R to the power of 4. Then you see that we have terms that can be cancelled out, so we can bring this 1 minus RS over R to the power of minus 1 on the other side and isolate R dot and the energy. R dot square minus energy square plus 1 minus RS over R multiplied L to the power of 2 R square plus C square epsilon equal to 0. So from here to here I just regrouped terms. Okay? I haven't done any magic. And now look. We have a kinetic term, R dot square. The energy of our system, this must be a potential. We can identify an effective potential. That we call VL. And you see that it's, this guy depends only on the Schwarzschild radius. So, I mean, we can make it parametric with respect to the Schwarzschild radius. So it's parametric with respect to the Schwarzschild radius. So what we could do is to identify a dimensional radius that we define as x. R over RS. And then you see that it is just R square over R square, we would have an RS appearing here that is annoying. And is just anyway a constant, is a real number. RS L square over C square. So I just call it lambda. because this is just a constant that parameterizes our system. You see, with respect to Rs, meaning which is related to the mass of our object, and the angular momentum of the incoming particle. Okay? But this is just a constant, so I can make express everything in a dimensionless, with respect to dimensionless, a dimensionless quantity. And in doing that, if I do that, I basically can define a dimensionless, a quantity, an effective potential that depends on a dimensionless variable, which is V of x over c to the power of 2. And it reads as 1 minus 1 over x, lambda square over x square plus epsilon. You see, this guy contains this effective potential, and it's a dimensionless. There is no epsilon, there is no Rs, there is no angular momentum. Everything is swallowed by this lambda. So you see, the specific numbers of our system are captured here. Therefore, when you say x, you can see what is your distance, radial distance, in units of the Schwarzschild radius. Let's now give a look at this potential. Oof, I need to clean. But we will do it next time, because time is up. Little summary. We then, after having the interior solution, which we could describe our metric as a function of radius within a scenario in which matter was different than zero, so the interior solution, we then placed ourselves outside the object such that we could use the same expressions that we had before. But now in this situation, we are able to get an explicit expression of our function A, characterizing the G0,0 component of our metric, in an explicit form. That's because pressure outside the object goes to zero, density outside the object goes to zero, and M of R is a constant. And this allows us to perform this simple integral and get the explicit expression for the function A that then finally give us the expression of G0,0. Then, with that, we have everything. We have the full Schwarzschild solution. So this is the four elements that contains all the elements. So that's the four interval that shows you all the elements of the Minkowski, of the Schwarzschild metric, spelled in this way. And there is a parameter Rs, which is the Schwarzschild radius, that is a function of the mass, the total mass of the object, creating the space-time distortion. Then we have seen that there are weirdnesses here. If the density of our object is so large such that the Schwarzschild radius is exposed, is in the vacuum where this metric is valid, where we must use this metric. If this is the case, we see that we have a singularity at R equal to Rs, and a singularity at R equal to zero, okay? Which will be there anyway. But anyway, we have this additional singularity. This guy is real, so it gives us a curvature that goes to infinity. This guy is a coordinate singularity. It's just given by our poor choice of coordinates. There are better ones that we are going to find and use. But this is left for later when we are going to discuss black holes. For now, we just sit around the surrounding of the sun, of the Earth, or choose the object you like, which is not a black hole, and investigate then the equation of motion of the particles. We are going to look how they move around. And you know that to look at the equation of motion, to define the equation of motion of your particles, you can use or the geodesic equation or the least action principle, the Hamiltonian principle, and so on. Okay. Here I decided to use the least action principle because it shows you more things and can also give you a kind of relationship between the behavior of particle in the distorted space-time and Newtonian gravity. We are going to look at that later. That's because I can define effective quantities, such as the effective potential that is coming about once applying the least action principle. Okay? Then, to make things simpler, since this is the effective potential, V of R, which is given by these two terms, depends on the matter of Rs, meaning the mass of your object creating the space-time distortion, and the angular momentum of your particle, I decided to make it a-dimensional. So I can express now distances with respect to the Schwarzschild radius. So if x is equal to 1, it means we are at the Schwarzschild radius. If x is equal to 2, we are at 2 times the Schwarzschild radius, which is the relevant piece of information, right? And I made also the angular momentum a-dimensional by creating this quantity, such that instead of using v of r, we are going to use this small v of x, which is expressed in this way. So in the next lecture, we are going to look at the behavior of this object for massive and massless particles, and we are going to see how very different is the scenario for these two different kinds of particles. And then we are making the comparison with the Newtonian case, and you will see that the scenario is very different with what you have in Newtonian gravity. Then we will start to discuss about the light cones in this sort of metric, and we will see what happens and why we call objects for which the Schwarzschild radius is exposed, is aside the object itself, why they are called black holes. Okay, so we will see through the study of the light cones, we will understand why this name came up. Good, thank you very much. We are done for today and see you next time.